Welcome to the first part of Vector Math Masterclass. I am Charan. Without any further ado, let's get right into it. First of all, what are vectors? The mathematical way of putting this would be, vectors are something that has magnitude and direction. But I want you guys to think that vectors are just a container of values that can define anything. It's like a box with compartments, where each compartment holds a number. Because we are working in 3D space, we can commonly understand vectors as a position of a point with three dimensions, or compartments, that are x, y, and z. We can visualize a vector as an arrow. The arrow points in a certain direction from the origin and has a certain length. The length of the arrow is nothing but the magnitude of the vector, and the tip of the arrowhead is the position of the point with coordinates x, y, and z. But how is it related to texturing? Every procedural or image texture needs a vector that helps Blender understand how to map it around the 3D mesh. This is defined by the texture coordinate node, which is a collection of floating point positions or vectors. If you want to know more about each mapping methods, you can check out Aaron's video where he explains them in detail. As I said, vectors can be anything. It doesn't always mean position. We can define our own vectors and its functionality. We'll look into it in the future videos, but some other examples that you can find in Blender are rotation and scale. In Blender's shader system, vectors are visualized as colors. The x-axis represents the red channel, the y-axis represents the green channel, and the z-axis represents the blue channel. Since there are negative vectors, it means there are also negative colors. Since we can't see all the negative values, they are all seen as black. We can see that in the object coordinates in the black octant, where all x, y, z values are negative. Technically, there are four types of vectors in texturing workflow: 1D, 2D, 3D, 4D vectors. One-dimensional vectors are basically scalars, which can be defined by a value node. We can consider the UV coordinates as 2D vectors because there is no Z component to it, or we can say that the Z component is 0. Whereas, 3-dimensional vectors consists of the Z component as well. We can make a vector using a combined XYZ node, and we can separate them into its individual components using a separate XYZ node. Finally, the hidden vector we have is a 4th-dimensional vector, not to be confused with the 4D in the noise texture and the mysterious W slider. In Blender, all colors are 4D vectors. The 4th component is nothing but alpha, which also means opacity. In the node editor, we have 4 types of sockets, which can also be referred as data types: purple, yellow, gray, and green. The purple socket represents vectors. The yellow socket represents colors. The gray represents float values, which can also be called as scalars, and the green represents shaders. We can convert most of the data types from one to another. When you plug a value into a color, the value has been given to the three channels. The same happens when you plug the value into a vector socket. Since we consider vectors as colors, when you plug the vector to color, there is no conversion, except a hidden alpha channel has been added internally. And when you plug the color to the vector, there will be no conversion, except the alpha channel will be removed. The main difference between colors and vectors comes when you plug them into the value socket. When you plug a vector into value, the three channels get averaged. But when you plug a color into value socket, the relative luminance has been outputted, which is basically using a color to grayscale conversion formula. When you plug any of these three sockets directly to the shader socket, internally Blender assumes an emission node with a strength of 1 between them. The only time we can convert a shader to other data types is by using a shader to RGB node in Eevee. Now that we know what vectors are and how is it related to texturing, we can get into the math. In the vector math node, we have 26 functions. Let's go through the basic ones in this video. We can add to vectors or subtract to vectors using the add or subtract function. Vector add is no different than the add function in the math node. Internally, what's basically happening is the individual channels of the two vectors are being added respectively, as shown here. Here, in our UV space, we know that the values go all the way from 0 to 1 in both x-axis and the y-axis. Now, when you add a value, say 0.1, to the UV coordinates along the x-axis, the values along the x-axis will be in the range of 0.1 to 1.1, which means we shifted the UV texture space by a value of 0.1. To see this better, let's add a Voronoi and let's connect the output of the add node to the vector input of the Voronoi. Now, when you increase the x value in the vector math node, we can see that our texture is moving along the x-axis. Now, when you change the function to subtract in the vector math node, the Voronoi is moving in the opposite direction. This is how the location input in the mapping node works. where add function is a location in point mode and subtract function is location in texture mode. Now, the next set of operations are multiply and divide. When you multiply the gradient that goes from 0 to 1 along the x-axis and y-axis with the value of 5, now it will go from 0 to 5, which basically scaled up our coordinates by 5 times in both directions. But the multiply function allows you to scale the individual axis with different values, like you can scale the x-axis by 5 units and the y-axis by 3 units. Let's test it. We have a Voronoi. Let's connect the output of the multiply node to the vector input of the Voronoi texture. Now, when you increase the multiplication value in the x-socket, we can see that the image is getting scaled along the x-direction. When it comes to divide, it is inverse of multiply. This is how the scale input in the mapping node works, where multiply function is a scale in point mode and divide function is scale in the texture mode. Scale function just multiplies a value to all the components of the input vector. This can be used as a replacement for the scale input in the mapping node for uniform scaling of the texture. Absolute is a function that basically makes all the negative values into positives. This makes all the 4 quadrants of texture space into positive quadrant. To see this better, let's test it on textures. Since we need negative values in our coordinate system, we can choose object coordinates, which by default has values that range from minus 1 to 1 in both x and y directions. But instead, we'll be using the functions that we learned so far and get the range using UV coordinates. We know that the range we have is 0 to 1. The origin is at the bottom right corner, which is 0,0. And the center of the plane is at 0.5,0.5. Shifting the origin to 0.5,0.5 is equivalent to doing some math that changes 0.5 to 0. Let's think about it. To change 0.5 to 0, we can either multiply it with 0, which will make the full coordinate system to 0, or we can subtract 0.5 to it. So let's subtract 0.5 from both x and y axis using the vector math node set to subtract. Now we have a range that goes from minus 0.5 to 0.5. To make it go from minus 1 to 1, let's scale it by 2 using a vector math node set to scale. Now let's add an absolute node. We can see that all the negative values have become positive values and made the coordinate system identical to the first quadrant, but mirrored about the axes. Absolute function can be used as mirror modifier. To see this better, let's add an image texture and load an image. Make sure you change the tiling method from repeat to clip. You can see that it's mirrored about the x-axis and the y-axis. Now, when you mute the absolute node, the mirroring is gone. Let's turn it back on. Now, you can move this image using a subtract node. This technique can be very useful in creating complex patterns, which we'll go through in the future videos. All the trigonometric functions in the vector math node are also entry-wise functions. There are not many use cases for any of them altogether, but you can make a wave texture using the sine or cos when you separate them into individual components. Let's do that quickly. Let's scale up the coordinates using the scale function in the vector math node. Then let's add another vector math node and set it to sine. Now, when you separate them into its individual components using a separate XYZ node, we can see that we have an alternate banding along the X direction and the Y direction. To understand this banding, you should understand the sine graph. Sine graph is basically a wave that starts from 0 and goes all the way up to 1 and comes back to 0. Then it'll go all the way up to minus 1 and comes back to 0, and it repeats itself. The black areas are negative values of the graph. We can add an absolute node after the sine node to turn all the negative values into positive. And this gives us the wave pattern which is similar to the wave texture. The same happens with cos, except there is an offset of pi by 2. When it comes to tangent, I have not seen a single use of it, but just so you know, the tangent is nothing but sine divided by cos. Since we consider vectors as colors, we can plug image textures into the vector socket of the procedural textures. This gives us some crazy outputs. Play with it. So let's summarize quickly. We can use add or subtract for offsetting the texture. And we can use multiply and divide for scaling the texture along the axis. We can use scale for uniform scaling. And absolute can be used for mirroring the texture and to turn the negative values to positives. The trigonometric functions are mostly useless in the vector math node, but can be useful for generating the wave texture. And that's it, we are done with the basic functions. I hope you are comfortable using these vector math functions in your texturing workflow. Consider subscribing and give this video a like to help the channel grow. Do check out our Patreon for more procedural resources. Thanks for sticking around. I'll see you in the next part.